my pleasure to moderate this ESC TV session. I am Martine Gila, currently president of the French Society of Cardiology, and it's my honor to moderate this session with Hélène Etchaninoff, which is in part of the board of the French Society of Cardiology and also responsible of the of our annual congress of Journée Française de la Société Européenne de Cardiologie. So we have in France several pioneers in the field of cardiology, and today we take the opportunity of the presence of the ESC in France to celebrate three of them. It is Professor Alain Cribier from Rouen, Marie-Claude Maurice from Paris, Massy, and Professor Pierre Corvol from Paris also. So just in order to begin this session, I would like to hear from you your stories, how you became so important pioneer, so important person in the field of cardiology and for the France and for everybody in the around the world. So Alain Cribier, you make a very, very important discovery with TAVI, because it's a disruptive treatment in the patient who have symptomatic aortic stenosis. But we would like to know how this crazy idea comes to you since when you begin with this very, very important story for the field of cardiology.
Well, thank you very much, Martine. And, you used the right word when you say crazy project, because a crazy project has been proposed to me when I was showing this project, trying to convince people. All the people said it was a crazy project, and I am sure that if I ask Marie-Claude Maurice and Pierre Corvol what they thought about the first cases of TAVI, they would also have the same word. Yes? Well, actually, you know, it's a long story. It's interesting, you know. First of all, I had a lot of chances in my life, and one of the first big chances was to be sent to Rouen as a resident in the 70s, and to meet there the director of the cardiology department, which was Professor Letac, who was a very special man, very open-minded to research and innovative technology in general. He had been trained in the United States, and he was very open to that. So this was the first chance. The second chance is that he sent me to Los Angeles, and I had the opportunity of working with Jeremy Swan and William Gantz, two people who are very well recognized, you know, in the field of innovative technologies. So I had a very interesting stay with them. And when I came back to Rouen as a fellow, I was very open, you know, to try to change the world of cardiology and try to find solution to what we call unmet clinical need. So there were, in the 80s, a number of unmet clinical needs, and one of the most striking one was certainly the fact that in the field of alveolar disease, we were receiving a number of patients with aortic stenosis, and many of these patients were denied for surgery and died very early thereafter because they were all symptomatic patients. The only possible treatment at that time was surgical valve replacement, as you know. And unfortunately, in the 80s, the age per se was a contraindication to surgery, and all the patients above the age of 70 in general were denied for surgery, at least in our department and in many other. So I could observe, you know, so this amount of patients who came to us in heart failure with aortic stenosis, and we were dying after two or three rehospitalization, and I found that absolutely unacceptable. So my first reaction was to say, why don't we try to do some less invasive techniques to improve them, and using a balloon catheter to dilate the aortic valve. So this is what we call now balloon aortic valvuloplasty. And so this is the first step. In September 85, we performed in Rouen the first case of balloon aortic valvuloplasty. And the idea of BAV, balloon aortic valvuloplasty, came by the fact that we were already dilating patients with pulmonary stenosis with balloon catheters with excellent results. And so I started to think that maybe something could happen if we dilated this calcific aortic valve, and that maybe it would improve the patient, but I was not sure, of course. And since we have time, I can tell you the story. I received in a department a 72-year-old woman who was extremely symptomatic. She had several syncopal attacks every day. And she was regularly declined for surgery because she was 72 years of age and she had an associated coronary artery disease. Too much for the surgeon, you know, so she was refused. So I said to Professor Letac, I said, why don't we try to dilate the valve? And he said, no, no way, you are crazy, you know, because if you put a balloon inside an aortic valve, you will have strokes, you will embolize the calcium, and you will kill the patient immediately, block the coronary arteries, and so on. It's impossible. And he said, no. So I tried three times, you know, to convince him. And finally, he went to vacation, and I called him in vacation, and I said, you know, the patient is coming again, so why don't you let me try something for her, because she's dying. And he said, well, okay, but if you want to do it, try it. And so the result was absolutely fantastic. Nothing happened, you know, all the symptoms were relieved. And I was myself absolutely fascinated because it was very easy to cross the valve, to dilate it, and the patients had no gradient at the end, and the symptoms disappeared, and she became a star in the region because she was in all the newspapers, you know, she started traveling, you know, to the south of France, and it was just unbelievable. So we immediately called all the other patients who had been declined, and we had a first series of balloon aortic valve replasty that we published in the Lancet. And having a publication in the Lancet is something, it's a very important milestone, you know. So immediately the medical community rushed on us, you know, they all came from every country, you know, to get trained to balloon aortic valve replasty. I started, you know, traveling everywhere in the world, you know, to dilate the valve in the United States, in Europe, in South America, and so on. It was fantastic. And the number of registries, the number of patients involved in this first attempt to improve the patients with aortic stenosis was absolutely unbelievable. We have more than 1,200 articles on balloon aortic valvoplasty, many registries in the United States, in Europe, and so on. But unfortunately, if everybody agreed to the fact that the patients had the symptom relieved, you know, came the idea that we had a very early restenosis, valve restenosis, and that the technique on that point was unacceptable because we could not redo a balloon aortic valvuloplasty every 6 months or every year. So I started thinking about another thing, and then came the idea of a percutaneous aortic valve that we could implant at the time of balloon aortic valvuloplasty. So this crazy idea of valve implantation is directly related to the failure of balloon aortic valvuloplasty. This is a continuation of the same research program, if I can say. So we have been doing I had the idea, you know, that the only possible possibility to implant a valve inside the aortic valve was to use a balloon expandable stent that could be crimped on a balloon, a stent which comprised a valve inside, and that we could deliver the stent and the valve at the same time as we do for balloon aortic valvuloplasty. So the first step was very important because we, with Hélène, actually, we went to the anatomy department and we did a very important autopsy study where we implanted stent in calcific aortic stenosis, and we realized that actually it was feasible. First of all, the calcific valve were fully opened by the stent. It was a Palma stent at that time. And also we could determine the optimal dimension of the stent, the height and the diameter, not to occlude the coronary artery, to break the mitral valve, you know. So we came to the conclusion that it was feasible with a stent that would be 15 to 17 millimeter in height that we could implant during cardiac catheterization. Then we had to put a valve inside. So then started my problems because I had to convince the biomedical companies, you know, that it was feasible. And all the companies in the world said it's a crazy idea. It will never work. It's impossible to make. We will kill the patients on the table. We will occlude the coronary arteries. The mitral valve will be dead and so on. And so after 5 years of complete failure, We decided to create a startup company, and this is what we did with Martin Leon in the United States, who was one of the only cardiologists in the world that thought that it could work, and two engineers, and we made the first prototype, and it was the beginning of the story. So maybe you have another question on the continuation of that, but.
I can add something because it makes understand why it was considered as crazy, because I was a resident, so I was there. And when Alain told me that he wanted to implant a valve through the femoral artery, I could even not understand how you could implant such large things across the femoral artery. So that's why it was crazy, because you had already in your mind that you can suture in a stent, crimp in a stent, and decrease the size. The fact to decrease the size of something, of a valve, this was crazy.
Yes, you are right, and this was one of the main challenges, you know, with the engineers of the company Aran in Israel that we found as a partner with the startup company Percutaneous Valve Technology. It was a company in Israel, a small company, and we said, you know, we want a valve that can be compressed without destroying the stent, that we can reopen without destroying the stent, with a valve inside, without tearing the valve, and so on. It was extremely difficult to think how they could make it, and they made it. And not only they made it, but they made it very fast. You know, after 6 months, they came back with a prototype, which was really corresponding to the drawings that I had made for getting a European patent on this idea. And I was absolutely fascinated because I had in my hand exactly the valve that I had in mind. So then, you know, with this valve, there was a considerable work in the lab, you know, to try to find out, you know, all the hemodynamic characteristics and the resistance to compression and so on, a book of challenges to fit. And then we started with Hélène again. In Paris, program on the animal model, and we selected the sheep because it was corresponding to the dimension that we wanted for the valve, and it was less expensive than a pig, actually, I must say. And so with Hélène, we have been implanting more than 100 valves in the pigs, in the sheep, I'm sorry, and we could develop all the delivery system, the approaches, the how to put the valve inside, how to select the size, and so on. We did a preclinical work which was absolutely complete during more than 2 years. And at the end of that, we start thinking about the possibility of implanting a valve in a patient. So this was a very extraordinary milestone, you know, because moving from the animal model to the patient is something that you have to live to understand what it is, you know. And actually, we were almost ready, not really ready, when we received in Rouen a patient who was very special because he was very young. He was 57 years of age. He had he was in cardiogenic shock. He had an ejection fraction of 12%, and he had multiple comorbidities, including an occlusion of the femoral arteries in such a way that the technique that we had thought had to be done through the femoral artery was impossible to make. So we had to use the transseptal approach, and this was the first patient that we attempted for TAVI. And believe it or not, it was a big success. So we did that transseptal. It was very stressful. And immediately the hemodynamics, you know, were totally changed and improved. There was no gradient. The patients recovered the colors on his face. And he was smiling, you know. He had several episodes of cardiac arrest before that, you know, so it was really amazing. And 8 days later, I have a beautiful picture that I show in the meetings, you know, the patients totally recovered, and he was doing very well. So this was fascinating. So then we had to move on and to try to convince the health authorities in France that we could do a series of patients for that. It was extremely difficult because all the experts were against it. But finally, we were allowed to do a series of patients on compassionate basis. All the patients in a pre-dying, you know, with a lot of comorbidities, cancer and so on. And we did 40 patients. And we had 80% of success using only the transseptal approach because I was asked to use the same technique than for the first one. And then we the technique started, you know, to spread in the world, in Europe and in the United States. In 2004, we had the total number of patients implanted was 100 in the world. And at that time, our startup was acquired by Edwards Lifesciences, which was something extremely important for the technology and for the development of this technology, because they had an army of engineers, you know, working on each point, you know, the delivery system, the valve itself, the stent, and so on. They modified slightly the valve that we were implanting initially, and they built the Sapien valve. And this is the valve which has been implanted in thousands and thousands of patients until 208 or something like this. With this valve, you know, many registries were done and the technique developed worldwide.
Thank you very much a lot, Alain, for this very, very impressive story. Yeah. And it's incredible. And we were not so happy when they changed the name of the valve, and because we will have Cribier valve, but it's a Sapien valve.
Well, so it doesn't matter.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, but for France, it matters to have an inventor, and we are extremely proud of that.
So now, Professor Corvol, I was a medical student in 1982 in the department of Professor Ménard. You were his associate professor. And even I didn't understand too much about hypertension at that time. I understood that something was happening at that time in the department, a kind of a big discovery. And then we understood that it was concerning the renin-angiotensin and aldosterone system. So you are an endocrinologist. How did it happen that you were interested by hypertension? What is your career at this time, and how did you discover these major steps on the physiopathology of this system?
Well, thank you, Helen. It's nice to see you again. Actually, to be frank, I'm not at all a cardiologist, but I became a cardiologist, in fact, because indeed, the discoveries, the contributions we have made on the renin-angiotensin system are useful for both cardiology, nephrology, and other diseases as well. Well, actually, when I was doing a postdoc in NIH in the States, I was working on sex hormones. I was interested, I'm still interested in sex hormones. But when I considered to come back to France, I was not so happy about the positions which was offered to me. And indeed, there was another possibility, which was worked out by Joël Ménard and Paul Milliez, which was to go back to Paris in a ward of nephrology. Nephrologists were interested and are still interested in high blood pressure. And I was offered at the same time a lab. And that was very important because I had a double training, both as a clinician, endocrinology, but also as a biochemist. And at that time, there was absolutely nothing very well known about renin and aldosterone. There was no assays. For example, renin was measured by bioassay, which was time-consuming. Aldosterone could not be measured at all. So when I came back, my duty was to implement in the world measurements of renin, aldosterone, considered as hormones, acting on the kidney and produced by the kidney, at least in the term, at least for renin, and also to develop a research, an area of research around the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system. I was interested in trying to work out what was renin. Renin was an enzyme, but very little was known for a good reason. Renin is a very, very rare molecule in the kidney. 1/500,000 of the proteins is renin. So it's impossible to purify it from human kidney. So we started with hog kidney, 70 kilograms of hog kidney to produce only 3 milligrams of renin. It's not exciting, I agree with you. But we were very proud of this achievement. So the next step was, how can we really do some more study on renin itself? There were two possibilities, luck, and second one was molecular cloning. We had luck indeed in the 1980s in the clinic. The luck was a patient with a renin tumor. Renin tumor is very rare, but provides a very severe type of high blood pressure. It was difficult to make the diagnosis because there were no CT scan at that time. It's a peripheral tumor in the kidney, so you cannot see it really by arteriography. And well, we decided to explore. We found the tumor, and from this tumor, we got a lot of almost pure renin, which was very important for the next studies. We could make antibodies, we could make a direct radioimmunoassay of renin, etc. And also at the same time, we decided to clone renin, which was a tour de force because it was really the early cloning in the, let's say, in the nephrology or in the cardiology area. Probably the cloning of renin was the first cloning on of a protein in cardiology. But that was very important because we could develop molecular probes. We could start to understand the processing, the maturation, if you prefer, of pro-renin, which is inactive, into renin. We could look at the structure, look at the active site. We could also begin to think of developing genetics of hypertension, because we could explore the possibility that renin had some polymorphisms which could be associated or linked with high blood pressure. And because we were successful and we were really the first to do that, we decided to clone angiotensinogen, which is a renin substrate. And again, we were very excited because we did it, and we found an association and a linkage between angiotensinogen polymorphism and high blood pressure in our hypertensive families. In total, I think we found we have collected something like 30,000 hypertensive patients. We had a record about their history of hypertension in their family. Of course, it was a little bit imprecise, but at least we could select those patients according to their family history. And we found an association and linkage between angiotensinogen gene polymorphism and high blood pressure. Then we clone angiotensin converting enzyme, which is the enzyme which activates activates angiotensin 1 into the active peptide angiotensin 2. And we had also contracts with several drug companies, especially Bristol Myers Squibb, which was at the same time developing captopril, the first ACE inhibitor. So we worked together very closely. And this was important for the design of next generation of converting enzyme inhibitors. So it's a little bit of luck, but I think more important maybe for those people who are listening to us is the fact your contribution can be made first because you have a great idea, you are persistent, as Alain said. You can also contribute by taking paths which are not the classical ones, and not, as I said, a cardiologist by training. I became, I hope, a part of the community in some way. I think it was important also to have a good training in biochemistry and molecular biology to make a contribution in the field of cardiology, and also in the field of pharmacology, because all these studies on the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system, we are not the only group who had done it, but we were really the pioneers. I think that was important at a time where it was very little known. When I started in 1970, my clinic in hypertensive patients, there was, as I said, nothing known about the measurements of these hormones. There was only ganglioplegic drugs or centrally active anti-hypertensive agent, nothing about renin-angiotensin blocker. the genetics of high blood pressure was absolutely ignored. We only knew that a third of the blood pressure variants was probably genetically determined. Actually, we don't know much more at the present time, except for few monogenic diseases which affect the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. In fact, we have discovered the complexity of a complex disease. Really, high blood pressure is a highly complex disease, very much polygenic, very much influenced by environmental factors. We are not discussing of personalized medicine, but at least with this system, we had contributed, I guess, to the management of hypertensive patients, patients with nephropathy, patients with cardiac insufficiency, and some other disease as well. Because when you know the structure of very precise elements like the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, you can develop drugs according to the structure and the discoveries you have made. So I'm proud also that many others have followed this path in our field, and I guess in vascular biology, generally speaking, France has really a place and can be proud of it.
Thanks to you.
Thanks to the group.
But just to explain, why were you interested by this molecule, renin? Did you have already the impression that it was involved in hypertension, or you said you just wanted to develop something which was not developed?
I was persuaded by my friend Ménard that was a key element in the regulation of blood pressure, water and salt metabolism. I was convinced also by the work of Arthur Guyton. Guyton was a surgeon. He got, unfortunately, a poliomyelitis, and he stopped doing surgery to build models about cardiovascular regulation. And Guyton is considered to be probably the first investigator to have developed a sophisticated model, analogic model. It was not at the era of informatics and digital era. But all his studies show that, in fact, kidney was central in blood pressure regulation. And in the kidney, a good candidate was the renin-angiotensin system. And many people make a contribution right now to Guyton for his conception, this simulation, you know, of blood pressure regulation. And that was very influential, not only for me, but for people working on blood pressure like Barry Brenner, for example, was absolutely convinced on that, Gavras, John Lara, etc. So a bunch of people worked on the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone for this also reason.
Thank you. So for those who don't know, you are now the president of the Académie des Sciences, which is a really incredible position. You are teaching at the Collège de France, and you have many other honorific positions. So this all this discovery led to this wonderful career. So Marie-Claude now. Marie-Claude, you are one of the most famous interventional cardiologists. We, with Martin, we are also interventional cardiologists, and we know that we are a rare woman in this field. So at that time, because it was probably about 30 years ago, why did you decide to, why were you interested by this field at the time where there was no stent, there was no balloon angioplasty? So how did you become interested by this? And how did you decide also to do research in this field, because there was not too much research to develop this treatment of coronary disease?
Let's say difficult to say, and I feel a little bit illegitimate with my two neighbors that I admire a lot. I'm not an inventor at all, but probably I liked yeah, since the beginning, I like the pioneering, yes. This is, I don't want to struggle. I like to work in team. I think that has been the case all of my career. So making people work together and go forward, forgetting a little bit each egos. And that was my contribution. And of course, I like always looking out of the box, saying, okay, what next? And as you probably know, I'm not very contemplative. So I like action. And in cardiology, went to CCU because it was dynamic. It was the beginning of fibrinolysis. So we are having a direct visible action on the outcome of patients. And yes, interventional cardiology, it was so natural. When I was seeing Michel Bertrand, Jean Marco, showing their first cases, immediately I said, that's for me.
I think you are too modest, because you create a lot of research in the field of interventional cardiology, and we are at the base for drug-eluting stent, and before, when Paul Barragan finds the great, the two antithrombotic, antiplatelet agents, you make the study. So without study, we can prove nothing. So I think it's very important. And
yes, absolutely. Yes, I believe strongly in evidence-based medicine, of course. But I think you need both. You need pioneering, but pioneering within constraints that are showing your result, discussing with others, and compare to what is already there. And it was so logical. Let's say, stent after balloons, that was a need, we knew that, and that perfusion balloon was not the solution. And then with the stent, we discovered that it was a lot of stent thrombosis, and this is when we created this group of French group of hemodynamics, where we did together coronary stenting without Coumadin, replacing progressively by the two antiplatelet agents you are saying. And then it's true that it was also obvious that restenosis was an issue. So each time I like pioneering and say, okay, what next to do with others?
And I think you like also to lead a team, because I remember, and also probably to succeed, to push your colleagues to do research, because I remember again when I was a resident, not a student, when you called me to participate to the collection of data of antiplatelet drugs after stents. Sometimes a resident can consider it's a boring work and you won't do it and it's like a corvée, but you have a spirit which you succeed to transmit, and in fact I was very pleased and very honored to work with you, because I knew that you were a leader in the field of interventional cardiology. So this is also a big quality, and you succeeded to build an extraordinary structure in Massy. This was at that time, there were not so many very important private structures, and Massy is one of the biggest structures, of course, also Toulouse, in France, doing clinical optimal work, doing a lot of research. You have built the CERC, which is an association to do research and to do international studies. So as you said, it's a major to advance with innovation. You have to give scientific evaluation of everything.
In this environment of male, I think it's very best, because at the beginning you are alone, and we are at the head of the major trial in PCI with DS, with DS stenting. So I think, how do you do it? You have a lot of obstacle or help? Do you have some recipe in order to help us to do the same as you said, as you do?
No, but you are the perfect example, both of you, that a woman can succeed in her career. I think that it cannot be an obstacle. If it's an obstacle, you even don't look at it. The people that are against, okay, you cannot change anything. You are a woman, and I'm happy with that. I never wanted to behave as a man. So you do things differently. I never like struggle, competition, but let's say when I have a direction, I think it's good for the patient, I go. And difficult to stop me, that's true.
Alain, I have another question. You told me a few years ago that at the beginning you wanted to be a cardiac surgeon. You were very involved, even when you were on vacation, you used to go to the OR. So was it the invasiveness of the technique which pushed you to cardiology, or what happened? Because you were very impressed by surgery at that time.
That's right. At the beginning, I was fascinated by surgery in general, but more particularly by cardiac surgery, because I did my medical studies in Hôpital Brousset. There was the cardiology department headed by Professor Dubost there, and they very nicely opened their door to me as a student, and they proposed me to be instrumentist in the during the OR, and I was absolutely fascinated by that. You know, like Marie-Claude, I don't like to be passive, you know, I'm active, and I wanted to see the results of my work immediately. And so I was fascinated. I stayed several years at Hôpital Brousset, and my goal was to become a cardiac surgeon. Actually, then came the year 1968, if you remember what happened in 68. And the context was, stop all this mess, you know, don't spend your time to go to examinations, to go to the interna and to the competition between you, you know. And so I decided not to be an resident. So it closed the door to surgery. And I must say that I was a little disappointed by the result of surgery, because in my practice at Hôpital Brousset, I was observing, you know, the very high mortality rate of this population who was operated by open heart surgery at that time. You know, there was a 50% mortality. It was just horrible. So it was difficult for me to accept that. And then I had the chance of entering at Hôpital Tenon. And they were starting their program of cardiac catheterization. And I was, again, like for surgery, I was fascinated by the fact that you could manipulate things inside the heart. You know, this was for me, you know, I felt it. So when I came to Rouen, Professor Letac was very interested by my experience acquired in Hôpital Tenon, and he said, you will take care of the cardiac catheterization lab. And as you said, at that time there was no interventional cardiology, it was just left and right heart catheterization. But then when they started with interventional cardiology, I was the first one to rush on it. I was really fascinated by that. So,
thank you. And just a last sentence to Professor Corvol. If you have some to our young colleagues, if they want to make a research, what is your advice for them? In one sentence, very short, it's possible.
Well, I wish I would be a young colleague starting doing research. I would say, well, look at what is promising right now. I think what is promising right now is the digital aspects of medicine and cardiovascular medicine, certainly not only in imaging, but certainly also in the understanding of the mechanism of action of hormones, protein, transmitters, because we have a bunch of techniques, molecular biology techniques, to explore from the DNA, messenger RNA, proteins, different sorts of proteins, different receptors. I mean, it's just fantastic. And because we will have the possibility of exploring this big data at the level of a single individual, but also at the level of many individuals, we will learn a lot of things which we could not approach otherwise now. So look at the digital era as a promising era.
So if we can summarize, because we are very proud of you, and if we can summarize, it's idea, persistence, and also a global approach of everything. So thank you very much indeed
and
for
passion,
your...
passion, of course.
Passion, yes.
Passion, yeah.
Thank you. Passion, yes, exactly.
Merci.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.